Good morning. So the topic that I am going to present on is traffic patterns and planning during an emergency. So I am Praveen Parchuri. I am associated with Machine Learning Lab at IIIT Hyderabad, and this is the work of my master's student Gaurav Gupta. So this is my bio. I joined IIIT recently, 2014 December really. So it's really 2015. My area is artificial intelligence. Before then, I was a postdoc at CMU, and before then, I was a PhD with Professor Milind. So my work was on developing a security system for Los Angeles Airport at that time, and significantly enhanced systems have been used across many places in the world. That is due to Professor Tambe and his group at USC. Our focus here, we wish to evaluate a building or an area. So maybe let me just show a diagram and then get back here. So this is a picture that my student put up for what is happening in an emergency evacuation. But then once I looked at this picture, then it occurred to me that what should I call this picture, which is the Bangalore traffic, right? So I mean, if this is emergency evacuation for Houston and this is how the normal traffic is in Bangalore, then I think we are in super emergency, or I don't know how to put it, that put the word here. But essentially, that's the problem we are tackling here, which is we want to evacuate an area. During evacuations, we can make some assumptions that police may have control over the area, so we can do some sort of centralized evacuation. So that's the assumption we're making here. And for the centralized evacuation, we use a Ford-Fulkerson algorithm, right? So it's a maximum flow. That is, we want to evacuate as many vehicles as possible out of an area, right? So that's why we use the Ford-Fulkerson algorithm. And our work specifically is to analyze human behavioral factors and biases, right? So Ford-Fulkerson is an already existing algorithm. It's a well-known algorithm. So all we are doing is we want to analyze what happens if a Ford-Fulkerson algorithm is applied in practice. That is, what if all the people are not going to follow the algorithm, right? So that's the human factors analysis that we are doing here. So essentially, these are the assumptions we're making. The police typically have a lot more information than the average driver in traffic. Because of that, the person or the driver should be willing to follow what the directions the police gives. But in today's world, with all the smartphones, with so much information available, it could be that a good percentage of drivers may have actually real-time information, right? So therefore, they may not be compliant, right? So they may have more information. So what they can do is they can optimize their own routes, and maybe they don't follow what the police tells, right? At least that's the analysis that we are performing here. The police use Ford-Fulkerson. The only interaction the police has with the driver is at the starting point, right? The starting point is the point of emergency. So at this point, the police tells the person or the driver, please go down this direction, right? Because we can evacuate you fast enough. But it could be that a driver might want to go in the south direction, but the police told, please go in the north direction. Right? So now the person may say, okay, I don't want to follow what the police is telling, but maybe I just want to go in another direction. At least that's the analysis that we are performing. What happens if that is done? So the analysis is being performed with a traffic simulator called Sumo. This is the graph that we are using here. I mean, obviously we can generate a lot more complicated graphs, but for simplicity, these are the kind of graphs we are looking at, where there are nodes and there are edges, and these show how many vehicles can be evacuated at one point of time. So obviously, these numbers are much bigger. We cannot have a 13-lane road usually, but at least that's the example that we have here. Our first claim is to verify first, indeed, is Ford-Fulkerson the best thing, right? So it is, that's the first analysis we have done. So for that graph, the Ford-Fulkerson told that you should have a flow rate of 23. That is, 23 vehicles at each point of time should be sent out. At least that's the solution given by Ford-Fulkerson. So what we did is, what if we send more vehicles and what if we send lesser vehicles, right? So that's the analysis we performed. So whether we do lesser number of vehicles or if we do more number of vehicles, what is happening is the total travel time is increasing significantly, right? So that is, that's the first experiment here, which is if you just deviate in terms of number of vehicles. So we are using a BDI architecture to model the agents, to model the human behavior here. That is, the humans, instead of just following the traffic, that is, instead of just being compliant to what the policy, the police tells you, if they use their own architecture to deviate, right? And we are using a BDA architecture, which is belief, desire, intention framework. Briefly, belief is what the agent knows about the world. Intention is what the agent wants to achieve. And the desire is what the agent wants to achieve. And intention is how the agent is going to achieve what it wants to achieve, right? So that's the brief overview of the BDA architecture. Essentially, we have come up with a path score that would help the agent to decide whether to just go along the police given path or to decide on its own path, right? So this is the path score we came up with, and this was done using trial and error. It's not really like we can justify why only these factors, why not other factors, but essentially there was some trial and error that was performed to come up with this particular path score. So what is happening here is, let's say we give percentage, right? 80% of the drivers are compliant, that is, they just listen to what the police tells, but at least there is a 20% population that is not compliant, and when they are not compliant, they are going to use that path score, right? They are going to use that path score, and they are going to say whether it's good for me to follow what the police tells, or is there a better path for me, right? Is there a path that has got higher score for me, right? And if it finds that, if the agent finds that there is a path with a higher score, then the agent will deviate and go along that path, right? So that's what is happening in this simulation. These are the factors in the path score. A is inverse of the distance left for the agent to reach the sink. This is a static data because we assume that the agent has got the map. B is the route priority. So priority is, for example, let's say there is a car, but it's short on gas, right? So then maybe it wants to pick a path where there is a gas station, right? So path priority can change based on what the agent wants, right? So that's what this factor B is. And C is the important factor, which is the human factor, right? So human factor in emergency, I'm going to come to the next slide, but essentially during emergencies, people may not behave as rationally, right? So it could be that they're in panic mode and they try to do certain things, right? So that's what this C factor tries to capture. And D is actually a factor that is derived from intelligent transportation, right? So if we have intelligent transportation, some data from intelligent transportation, then we model D, otherwise the weight for D will be zero, right? So at least that's the way we model this scenario, where if you've got some intelligent devices that are giving you information, we can use it to build D. If you don't have such devices, then the weight for D becomes zero, right? So that way we have modeled a variety of factors. The first one uses static data. The second one uses personalized preferences. The third one is human behaviors in emergency. It's not a proactive behavior, it's more a reactive behavior, right? Because during an emergency, it can happen that people can just react to scenarios because of their biases, because they're afraid of certain things or whatever, right? And D is a factor that models data that comes from intelligent devices, right? We don't explicitly tell what those intelligent devices are, but it is going to encompass that, right? So that's what D factor here is. Okay, so let me go into what the human behavior here is, what we have modeled so far, and it's a very simple model we have used so far. There are three particular models we're using. One is preference for high density, right? So we see an emergency, and then people and the driver says, okay, more people are going in this direction, let me just go there, right? It's not because I have got certain goal, but because I see that a lot of people are going there, so I'm biased to go there, right? So that's the first factor. The second factor here is preference to lower density. So there may be some people who say, oh, okay, a lot of people are going there, I would want to go in the direction where no one is going or lesser people are going, right? So that's the second bias we are modeling here. And the third one is randomness due to panic, right? So these are the drivers who don't really, who are not actively thinking. They are just saying, oh, okay, there is an emergency, I just want to rush out, right? So they just pick up a random route and they go along with it, right? So that's the human behaviors we have modeled here. And these are the proportions that we have put. Again, these are all based on trial and error. So I'll show one graph, one of the results based on the human behaviors. So this particular graph is generated only using the human behaviors. That is, factor A, B, and D are set to zero, right? The weights for those factors are set to zero. So only the factor C is being evaluated in this graph, and that is the only factor we are showing. And what we are saying is the x-axis shows what is the percentage of vehicles deviating, That is, here it is 0% of vehicles deviating, that is, everyone is following what the police is telling. 10% says, if 10% of the drivers don't follow what the police tells, this one tells if 20% of the drivers don't follow, 40% of the drivers don't follow, right? And this is the pattern that we have got here, which is the overall average speed. So we are measuring the average speed here. The overall average speed is this graph. The ones that follow are doing significantly better, right? Ones that follow the police directions, and the ones that are deviating perform significantly below here. And all these evaluations are performed using Sumo simulator. None of the behaviors are generated by us. So which means that it's a fairly reason. So Sumo is accepted as a reasonably, So it's accepted as a reasonably realistic traffic simulation. So we just use that to perform these experiments. So I think my time is over. So I will skip the rest of the graphs. And the conclusion is basically that during emergency evacuations, we need to take human factors into consideration, right? It's not just because the police tells you go in this direction, not 100% may follow it, right? So if the 100% don't follow it, then the police, while developing their algorithm, may want to account for this, right? Because if they don't account for this, then whatever they have planned may not be successful, right? So that's the conclusion here. Any questions? Yes.
How representative is Sumo of Indian traffic
conditions? Sumo is not that good for Indian traffic conditions. So it's really for Western countries.
So are you doing anything?
I am not personally doing anything on the simulator part. Any other questions? Yes.
In some sense, these conclusions are not really surprising, right?
Yeah, that is true. So it's only that we are trying to see exactly what is the extent of the effect and so on. Anything else?
Yeah, actually, did you follow this up for the recommendation? Suppose the police knew this is how the people are behaving.
Yeah.
Do you also have the algorithmic way to come up with the strategy?
We haven't yet done that. So I think that's something we want to look into.